Hey, this is Steve Kunken. I urge you to subscribe to Eddie Mata's YouTube channel and podcast. He's an awesome interviewer, great guy to hang out with. You're going to learn a ton about anybody he hangs out with. It was a blast being with him. So do it. Treat yourself.
So here we have it. The man of the hour. A well-respected actor in the Broadway community. He's been in film, TV, and recently, he's on a hit show. Please welcome Billions actor, the Long Island kid, Stephen Kunken, in the house, baby. How are you?
Mr. Mata, what a pleasure. What an absolute pleasure to be with you here on the Eddie Mata Show.
Oh, man. Well, it's an honor to have you. I mean, listen, your show, you know, we'll get to that a little bit, but jeez, you guys are, it's Showtime, baby. You know, and the right network, too. But Steve, let's turn back the clock a little bit. I want to know, where were you in 1986, October 27th? And remember, I'm giving you a hint. 86, October 27th. Where were you that night?
I was in, God, that's awesome. I was in the den of my parents' house on Long Island. And I was going absolutely bang crazy off the panel walls, the wooden panel walls of their Long Island house. I couldn't believe it, man. That was just so nuts. It was like that entire series, you know, all the way up to the end was just absolutely crazy town. I never thought the Mets were gonna win that, but you know, Buckner, all the Mike Scott stuff in the series before with the scuffing of the ball. I mean, it was crazy. It was a crazy series. I felt like that was like baseball at the absolute max. If you're a Met fan, I think everybody else probably just wrote it off.
Listen, I'll tell you one thing. You were what, like 14 years old at the time?
Yeah, yeah. And but that was like, I mean, like it was between the Islanders and the Mets. I was like, those are some good years on Long Island.
Oh, yeah, well, of course, yes, you did. But, you know, what about two nights before in Game 6 when Buckner made that error? Were you like, remember, you guys were down by like 3 or 4 runs.
Oh, we were done. We were done. I was like, this is over. We're done. We're, you know, and then when that happened, I was like, what? And it was such a team of like scrappy dudes. I mean, between Backman and Dykstra, and it was crazy running out of the you know, the base path, the tag first. Remember that? It just seems in that when the ball went through Buckner's legs, it was like, we're winning this. This is ours. We're taking this. So, you know, you can tell. It's funny. It happens sometimes. And if you love sports, you can see it. You can see the air go out of the balloon for a team. You can just watch it like go. And it can be, they can be up. They can be up 2 games and you go, I think that's it. I used to watch it with the Knicks and the Bulls all the time.
Oh.
And you'd be like, I think the Knicks got it this year. The Knicks got it. We got this. I was actually at the game. I was at the game Charles Smith. It was the triple pump fakes underneath the net that they couldn't get in. Smith, right? Wasn't it?
Charles
just
Smith?
Completely blanked on his name. Yeah, it was Charles Smith, right?
Yeah,
when he
did
all the pump fakes under the net.
Yeah.
And it was Horace Grant and Michael Jordan and Scottie Pippen all hacking away at him.
Yeah.
And he couldn't get the ball. I was sitting there in Madison Square Garden. But you could see it was like that moment. That ball goes in, the series is gonna be the Knicks. And then it was it. They acquiesced and they gave it up over time. And then the Mets, and you knew in that moment that it was like the Red Sox are done for.
Well, right? Actually I wanted you guys to beat the Red Sox because, you know, that's our rivalry as a Yankee fan.
Yeah, it sure is.
Steven, growing up in Long Island, right? Brookville, Long Island, your father a dentist. Was he hard on you about, like, brushing your teeth and flossing?
He was pretty good. He was pretty good. You know, like, the big thing that I remember was that we sort of, like, we lived in a kind of low density area. When I grew up, where I was like a pumpkin farm. Like literally the back of my property was a pumpkin farm. And so to get from one house to the other, it wasn't like a great neighborhood where you could just like go and hit 50 houses in an hour. It was like, you had to walk to get to a house, to go down the driveway. And my dad's big thing was like, he was a kid's dentist. So he was like, I can't serve candy to kids. That seems like completely like, you know, pumping the pond or whatever that expression might be. But he was like, so I have to give, he gave out pretzels and pennies. And you'd see these kids who just walked like a mile to get to our house. And you'd see like, they'd come down the driveway and they'd be like, oh man, dude, this sucks. We've come all this way and we're getting like pretzel sticks and pennies. And then you'd see them tell the other kids at the top of the driveway. I look out the window. I was so excited to see, you know, trick-or-treaters. And you'd seem to be like, don't even, it's not worth it. Just keep going. That was like my big sadness as the son of a pediatric dentist, was it was like Halloween was always a bummer. Total bummer.
So you couldn't,
but he was pretty good.
You couldn't drink any sodas, right? At home?
We didn't have a lot of soda. You know, I think subsequently I just developed a massive sweet tooth. It's all the same because I was like, and it's the worst candy. It's like the candy, like some people are like, I love chocolate really dark. I'm like, give me a bag of Brock's jelly beans. They've been pulled out of the basement from like the Easter before. You got to crack them like a bag of ice. Otherwise the sugar is all like congealed. Like that to me is... That's candy. That's
big leagues right there.
It's divine. Yeah, totally.
Steven, you and your brother, you guys were competitive, yes. Are you? You growing up?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, totally. I mean, my brother Jeff is a great, hilarious guy. And he's 2.5, 3. He was 3 years older than I am in school, than I was in school. And, you know, that he's my best friend still. So we were definitely competitive, but in the kind of way that you're competitive with an older brother where it inspires you as opposed to like really, you know, ends up getting you into any kind of massive trouble. But we were definitely competitive.
So is it true, like when you guys were in the basement, you would like try to portray actors, you and him?
We did. Yes, we used to like do mostly interviews like this. I'm living my childhood dream. Like we'd come up with like fake movies that we had done and we'd be like, so what was it like being out on, I think one of the names of the movies we had was like High Karate or something like that. Mm-hmm. And like was the set and we would pretend that we would interview each other. And then invariably they would end with like, the interviewer would say something nasty and then we would fight. You know, it'd be like, it would leap across and be like, don't ever ask me that question again. I'm inspired by like the Sean Penn era, I guess, really.
So like when you were a freshman, he was a senior. Is that how it was?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. So the show Animal Crackers, you did it with your brother.
I did. Wow. You're running deep. Hey, Ma, this is some good stuff. I love it.
Listen, buddy, I go all deep, my man. I want classics. I want people to be inspired by your stories. Go ahead.
All right. So, yeah, Animal Crackers. I was a freshman in high school. My brother was a senior. It was sort of his send-off show. He was a big deal back at Friends Academy on Long Island. We had a great drama teacher. And my brother was going to be Groucho Marx in Animal Crackers, which is a fantastic, mm-hmm. you know, fun musical. And I got cast as a freshman, which was a little bit of a coup for me. I was super excited, but I got to be Chico. And so all of our stuff was like opposite of each other. And it was kind of an amazing full circle moment because we went from being like all the stuff that all of our patter that we had worked on all of our lives down in our basement. Suddenly people were like in an audience watching this. And we just had like a real, real ease with each other. And he's really funny. I mean, if my brother had wanted to do this, I think he would have had a huge success. It was weird. I've said this before in other interviews. I think I kind of followed in his wake, and then I got to step out of it a little bit. You know, I think there was no template in my life growing up in and amongst my family of somebody who went into the arts for a profession. So I think he like broke the ice by doing it all through high school and college. He was really big into improv comedy. And I think he had spent so much of his energy breaking the ice that way. He didn't necessarily have it to go that next step, which is turn it into a profession. And I think it was so much easier for me early on that I did. Then my next was to knocking down the barrier of thinking of it as something I could do for a living.
And
making that big mistake.
That moment came when you were in Tufts University, right?
Yeah.
You were at were you a major in the drama at Tufts? Was that your major?
Tufts. I was, you know, at Tufts, I was like a million different majors for every 5 minutes. I was a psychology major for for, I think I actually graduated with a psychology major too, but, and I was an Eastern religions major for a little while. I mean, I just kind of moved all over the map. And then finally I looked and I was like, I have all the credits to be a drama major and I love it. And those classes seem to me to be like, have zero work to them. It's all stuff I love doing. So I'm just going to do it. So yeah, I did. I ended up with a drama major from Tufts.
And then it was that one moment you were designing something for a set and you said, this is it. This is what I want to do the rest of my life. Tell me about that experience.
It's awesome. Great question. Well, you know, I was sitting in a class. I had a bunch of other things that were piling up for different classes, different responsibilities that I had to do. And, you know, I had work in all these other classes. And I think the project was designing, like we were picked out of a hat and we had to design a kind of walkthrough installation of the whatever Shakespeare play you pulled out of a hat. And I ended up getting lucky and I pulled Hamlet out of this hat. And they gave you all the resources of the school. So you could stay at the theater as late as you wanted to do. And you could basically make a walkthrough ride of this play so that whoever walked through this kind of had like the experience of the play of Hamlet, whatever Hamlet meant to you, mm-hmm. or you know, the Scottish play or whatever it was. And I remember being like, looking up at the clock and being like, all right, it's 2:00 in the afternoon. I have to piece out this other time for these other classes at other points in the day. Look back up at the clock and now it's 10:00 at night. And then I was like, whoa, wow, I really am shortchanging my, you know, psychology test tomorrow. Looked up at the clock and it was 4:00 in the morning. And I realized I literally had the day just was like the hour hands were like one of those movies where the calendar things, the mm-hmm. pages just fly off the calendar. And it was like, I realized in that moment that it was, the goal, I think in a person's life is to find the thing that makes life just seem effortless, or makes you feel, not effortless is the wrong word because there's always effort in it, but that makes the time feel like it is both valuable and fleeting, because you are loving so much of what you're doing that you're like, you know, you're trying to hold on to the minutes. And I realized then that was like, this is what I love. I love it so much that I'm willing to shortchange everything else. And why not, instead of try to continually drive through the wake and cut across the grain, why not just turn the boat into it and like really try to pick up some speed and get the tailwind and go for it. And it was really in that moment at school that I was like, I'm going to at least give it a go. I don't know if I'm going to be able to make it, because nobody ever knows in this career, but I was like, I'm going to give it a shot.
So when you told your parents you want to do this, and I know they wanted you to become a lawyer, right? Is that what they said? They preached to you to become a lawyer?
Yeah, my dad was a professional, so he was, mm-hmm. you know, my mom was a teacher, and then she worked with my dad, and I think they were both like, you know, yeah, you're going to a good liberal arts college, you're probably going to be, you know, doing something that we takes that degree and puts it to use. And I think they thought law would make sense. I was somebody who liked to talk and I liked to think and I liked to put together an argument the way you put together an argument for a character. And so that seemed like the logical thing. I was actually doing a play in a summer stock theater company, and this one of the guys I was directing, or I was either directing or I was in it. I had done a bunch in that same summer, and we cast a guy who was a lawyer come actor in the summer. And I remember him sitting down with my family and being like, hey, can come here, you know, Dr. and Mrs. Kunken, come here, sit down. He said, you know, your son really wants to do this. And I know you really want him to be a lawyer, but I got to tell you, I'm a lawyer and all I want to do is this. And your son is good at this. And you should let your son do this. Because I can tell you, being further down the road as a lawyer who wanted to do this, if every day seems like I've missed out on something. Wow. And I hope you don't inspire your kid to do the same. And I remember my parents like being like, that's interesting. That's different advice. And it's coming from somebody who is a professional as opposed to another actor. It was like, you should join the circus like all of us. You know, this was somebody who another professional talking to them. And I think that was like the first big chink in the armor that was like, All right. Well, if you're going to go, and their big thing was like, if you're going to go about doing this, then at least approach this, whatever the circus is, at least, you know, approach it in the way that they as a family knew, which was like be, you know, go to class, you know, try to apply to a school, try to do it with, don't just throw yourself into the city and hit the pavement, which is a completely legitimate way, I think, for a lot of people to become actors. But in the way I had grown up, I think I would have bailed on the career because the career is too hard. And I think if I was just there opening the backstage, I think my anchor wouldn't have been in the sand deep enough. And I think the storms that everybody feels as an actor getting going would have knocked me off mooring.
That's amazing because it's like another person telling your parents and they actually listen to him. But if you tell your parents, they're like, well, do you know the consequences? Do you know what's going to happen? You're going to be struggling, yeah, right? But this guy said it to your parents. You're like, okay, you know what? Let him go. Yeah. So here we are. Now we get to Juilliard. Oh. I want to know the exact schedule. You wake up in the morning in the acting program at Juilliard, because it's also music. Yeah. Mm-hmm. What do you do? Talk to me. Tell me throughout your day, because this is the Navy SEAL for actors at Juilliard, right? This is like all day, rehearsals, you name it, no excuses. You have one doubt, get out of that program. You can't be lazy in this. So talk to me about it. You wake up in the morning, then what?
All right, so you wake up in the morning, and each year is slightly different because it's a four-year program. Mm-hmm. And you wake up in the morning, and most of the time your first class is like 9 o'clock in the morning. So you wake up in the morning, you have a cup of coffee, you find yourself at movement class. So movement class was taught, each year was taught either by this incredible teacher named Moni Akim, who taught this crazy kind of movement that was all about isolation and being able to use your body. And every morning would wake up with like this thing that he would do where you go, and you do this whole crazy like thing. But it ultimately, it was about getting your body prepped to, you know, the thing about Juilliard, which is interesting, is Juilliard, especially when I was there, really was a classical theater training school. And with a caveat at the end, which is like, we're going to give you skills. We're also going to try to give you the skills of being a film and TV actor. But so much of that program was about your voice and your speech and coming up with standard dialect that you could then deviate from, that was really geared towards doing classic stage work. So you have voice in the morning, then you'd have speech class soon thereafter, which was all about beginning to hear your regionalisms. I have a lot of them. I grew up, everybody does, but beginning to find like a phonetic alphabet so that you could hit a kind of neutral so that you weren't trying to play an Englishman, you know, and sounding like you're from Long Island. You could, how do you move to different sounds? Mm-hmm. And then you, over the course of the day,
hold on, the classes, the movement class is what, an hour and a half?
An hour and a half, yeah.
And then right after movement, you will go to voice and speech for another hour and a half.
Yeah, about that. Maybe an hour, maybe voice was an hour. Movement was usually an hour and a half. And that was like, first year was taught by a guy named Daryl, and in that class was like boot camp. It was just basically like you're chub and you got to get there and you got to hone your body. And everybody was like calisthenics. And then second year began sort of like building on what was a stronger chassis and building like, you know, mm-hmm, stuff for isolation.
So after voice and speech, then you probably have lunch, I'm guessing, and then go right back to, now what's your classes in the afternoon throughout the day?
Afternoon was typically like a scene study class or some kind of like text class. So either like Shakespeare, like learning about, you know, mm-hmm, all the different, you know, things with iambic pentameter and how that manifests and acting styles. And then you would basically, you would do an acting class in the afternoon, and that would kind of get you to the 4 or 5 o'clock range. Mm-hmm. And then you would start working on, at night, from like 5 to 9, you'd work on whatever play your class was working on at that point. So sometimes they broke the class up into 2 or 3 plays so that everybody had more to do. Sometimes it was a big Shakespeare play and you'd split like a Henry V over three different people, and you'd swap the cast. But that would be the night. You'd basically rehearse a show until you fell asleep, and then you'd just get up and do the whole thing over again. Until you got to the fourth year. The fourth year was different because you were building a season of rep of shows. So every night you were really rehearsing shows that you were going to do one after another and then put them all together in a season.
Steven, would you think that was a 16-hour schedule a day on your daily schedule at Juilliard? Because I'm thinking 8 a.m. till like 8 p.m. is 12 hours. And then you add four more at night to rehearse and work on things. You add 3 to 4 more hours. That's a long day for a young kid like you. After, well, you were 22 at the time, I'm assuming.
Yeah, 21, yeah. Yeah, it was a long day because even when you were done, it was like, well, now you got to go learn your lines. You know, you go home at night, and if you had a lot to do, you had to learn your lines. Or you had to perhaps prepare something sometimes for, you know, a voice speech class. You have to learn a piece of poetry, or for acting class, you'd have to find somebody after, you know, up in the dorm or at your apartment, wherever you live, and be like, let's work that scene because tomorrow we're presenting that for acting class. It was an all in. It really was like those 4 years were hard. They were a joy, but that came later. I would say that I think my other friends who went to other schools like Yale and NYU and Purchase, and I think they felt the people in their class, I think, stayed closer together than our class. We were just thrown so hard together for so long, and especially the period of time that I was there. It was not a kind, gentle place. Really wasn't. I mean, I wish I could say that it was. I love the school. I'm incredibly grateful to the school. But it was tough. It was like boot camp. You left there and my class kind of scattered to the winds. I don't think many of us, you know, I'm thrilled now when I see them, people from my class. But it didn't necessarily, especially my year in particular, didn't engender this kind of like, we're a company. They did some weird things at the end that they don't do anymore, which I think really kind of gives you an example of what the school's manifesto was, which was like, your whole time at Juilliard is kind of building towards this entry into the professional world. And on the last like chunk of time, you basically do this scene night for all the agents and managers and, you know, casting people in New York. And because it's Juilliard and it's in New York and it's a prestigious school, everybody comes. It's a big deal and people come. And you've been working as for 4 years as like this company of actors, and you're building on this theme that you are a, you're a company. And then what they do is they put everybody's name on a list with a little checkbox. And at the top, you write like, I'm Sonia, whatever, from CBS casting. And then you check, I want to see this person, I want to see that person. It was based just on the night. So maybe there's 200 people there who want to see this person, that person. And what would make sense and what they have begun to do later is they'd take a night and they'd figure out who it was and they'd hand you a packet to tell you who you should go contact and see. When I was there, they took all of the stuff and they posted it on a board. And so everybody got to walk the line and see who had gotten 15 people interested in them. Some people got no people interested in them. Some people got all the people interested in them. And it was kind of this moment of like, yeah, you've worked as a company. The business is looking at you. And now you know who's being picked out of it. And it was rough. I think that left this horrible taste in my year's minds for a long time.
Well, can you imagine a guy that went there for 4 years and he's not on the list? I mean, he's probably thinking, did I waste my money? They're like, you know what I mean? Like,
it happened in there. That my class, that happened a lot. There were a bunch of people, and some of those people, I have to be honest, some of those people were by far the most promising, best people in my class. And for whatever reason, you know, you get to see these people act over the course of 4 years. And you're like, God, that guy, when that guy hits to be 50 years old, he's going to be the most interesting actor in the world. But they're seeing this guy at the age 25 and they don't have that kind of context. And so they're like, what am I going to do with you? I don't know what I'm going to do with you. I can't hold on to you for 25 years. And so there were a bunch of people in my class who were amazing, who were so distraught about the reception that they got from the profession at that point, that I think they just sort of bailed.
How many? Can you remember how many people wanted to see you? Did you have that count? Can you remember that?
I don't remember. I know I did. I was really lucky. I was really lucky. But it was funny because I did two scenes. You'd get to do two scenes, and I picked one scene with that I was like, this scene is gonna crush. This scene is. It was a Michael Weller play. And it was really intellectual. It was all the stuff I wanted to do. It had emotional range, but it had a kind of explosive, like, anger to it. And I was like, this one is going to – I'm securing my future and the world with this one. And I was, and then the second one was this play. It was called I Love You, You're Perfect Now, Change, that had just come out. And it was like – it just seemed like cannon fodder to me. I was like, this is just drivel. And it was the – it closed – that one closed the evening. And I remember thinking, like, I can't, I'm going to ruin all of my chances by doing this. And of course, literally every person that I talked to was like, that first scene sucked. That scene from I Love You, You're Perfect, thank God you did that. And I almost walked out. I almost didn't see it. And that's why I called in. And that's what it is. You realize in that moment that the majority of the people who are there are in the business as a kind of commodity. And they want to see you as like where you fit. You spend all this time in this bubble thinking you could play an 80-year-old man at 20 years old. And that's just not the truth. Eventually, when you're 80, you'll play an 80-year-old man, but not at 25. And so it's like in that moment, the career comes and the truths of the business come crashing in on you. And you realize, yeah, I gotta have to jettison some of what I thought, you know, about the democratic nature of this business, because it's not. It just isn't. It's a really fickle, strange business.
So, Stephen, when you graduated from Juilliard, it's more reality is welcome to the unemployment world, we call it, right? Anytime you graduate. Did you have an agent at the time right away? I mean, did they sign you? Did they freelance you? What did they do afterwards?
I got a great agent. Right out of the gate, got really lucky. I got one of those peachy right out of grad school jobs where I was working. I was basically had like, you know, 10 lines at Shakespeare in the Park doing Henry VIII, which is fantastic cast. I got cast in that before I graduated. So I knew as I was coming out of school, I had my first job. And I think that got me my equity card, or it got me close enough to getting my equity card. But I got out and I had this wonderful agent at a place called Talent Works, which at the time was called Harder Woo. There was a great agent there named Jay Kane and Alan Willig and Diana Dussant. There were these three really, really terrific agents. And I was incredibly lucky that I started my career with them because they were all really very, very smart. They also saw the long game and they knew that, you know, there was going to be a period in which I was going to have to readjust to what I thought my career was going to be. And they were right there helping me figure that out. So I got really, really, really lucky that they were my first agents and they were great.
Steve, what's your take on auditioning? A lot of actors, even, you know, star actors, you know, and, you know, guys that have true artistry, they hate auditioning. They're like, I suck at it. You know, how were you when you were auditioning?
You know, auditioning's tough. It's really, really hard. And it's a game that evolves over time. And it goes back and forth. Like, you can think you really have nailed it. And then you are working on a show for a year. And then when you're back in the audition game again, you're like, whoa, I'm befuddled by this. I mean, the big adjustments that I think you need to make to give yourself the best opportunity is to realize, and now that I've sat on the other side of the desk as a director, you come in as an actor, I think a lot of the time with this hope and that you're going to get the job, that you're going to, you know, that's all you can think about. You can think about how the story unfolds for you if you get the phone call. Oh my gosh, I get the phone call. I get to do the part. I get to be there. Maybe somebody will come and see it. Maybe I'll get a good review. Maybe this will build this, blah, blah, blah. And so you're just trying to fit into what you think that is that they're shopping for. And the truth is, when you flip the paradigm a little bit and you realize all that those people want when they're sitting on the other side of the desk is to have their answer come walking through the door. They're just praying that because they like, I have to cast this. And I'm just hoping somebody comes through the door and makes an argument for themselves that is undeniable. And half the time, if you don't get a part, it has literally nothing to do with you. You're too tall, you're too short, you haven't worked with a director before, don't have the right kind of chemistry for the other person, you're not the right color, the right whatever. Mm-hmm. It's not in your control. So that you chalk off 50% that way. But you can always give an audition, no matter how bad or how wrong for the part you are. You can give an audition if you're informed and you're prepared, that it's like, this is what I would do with it. If you're looking for me, which I think you probably should be, if you're looking for me, this is what I would do with it.
But hold on.
Now you can make your decision.
You see, but how the way you said that, Stephen, when you said, this is how I'm going to do it, and if there's any adjustments, I got your back, right? But that's more of confidence right there. That's more saying to yourself, look, like when I audition, I say to myself, I got the part already. I'm going to be relaxed. I'm in rehearsal right now. That's when I audition. Yeah. You know, I can't say, right, oh my God, serious regular. Oh my God, this could change my life. Forget it. It's like being in the batter's box. You can't think, well, what happens if it's full count? What happens if it's 2-1? No, man. It's the moment now. Whatever's coming now, right?
I was going to say literally the exact same analogy. You can't be thinking later in the count. You got to take each pitch as it comes to you. You got to take each pitch and focus on the fundamentals. You know, you got to be prepared when you start an audition. You know, you can't leap ahead of what the moment is. You got to do your work, and you do your work in the room. And I think the way you put it is great. Yeah, it's first day of rehearsal. This is what I'd be doing.
I got the part already. I'm first day of rehearsal. Because when you say that to yourself, when I say that to myself, I'm more relaxed. But the reason I'm relaxed is because I'm prepared.
It's really hard to be relaxed if you're not prepared.
Exactly.
Then you're faking relaxing, and that's a second acting on top of your first acting. It's hard.
Exactly. Steve, I also want you to emphasize, how important is it during a table read? And that's what people don't realize. Table read's not just reading lines. I mean, you know, you're doing your research a little bit, right? You're crafting, right?
Well, not only that, you are, you know, for people who don't know, most people probably watch your show, like a table read is the first time you're either reading a script or with the cast. And if you're in a TV show, the table read is like the first time that anybody's heard these voices out loud. So beyond just starting your process of figuring out who this person is, you're providing an invaluable service to your writers on a TV show. Certainly, you know, maybe the author at the table read of, like, for Chekhov's dead, so who cares? But you're providing an invaluable service for your director, your fellow actors, and yourself. But for writers, you know, I know, like, on Billions, where the table reads are probably the most exciting thing that we get to do. It's like you're taking the thing out of dry dock for the first time, and everybody gets to see and look at it. And from a self-preservation sensibility or self-betterment, it's like, if you blow it and you're just phoning it in. I think there was a whole period of time in my life where I watched people at table reads, especially the big actors, you know, mm-hmm. like the one or two on the call sheet, kind of look at it and not give you anything. They'd take a table read and they'd be like, yeah. And it was almost like, I don't want to be judged on this. I don't want you to cut anything because of this. I don't want to give you any of the power. So I'm just going to mumble this through. And I saw that a bunch of times. Wow. Where it was like, I'm going to give you nothing. That is not it on Billions. People go for it, you know, because what good are you doing? It's a high wire act. What we do is dangerous as actors, and you got to have skin in the game, and you should have skin in the game from the jump, not from when it's finally gets into your close up, I think.
Yeah.
And I think it's like, you know, that is not the case in Billions. And I think people who come in and they do, you know, a new arc, or they're doing a guest on Billions, I think it's really fun for them because they sit around that table of some really fabulous actors. And you're like, okay, ball's going fast. It's not a lot of, like, you know, get up to speed. It's go. The ball's going. And that makes you just feel like when you get to the set and you're ready to shoot it, You've heard the energy. You know what it's going to be.
Well, Stephen, before we talk about Billions, hold on. I got a lot about Billions, but I want to know your theater career too, okay? Now, as an actor, you know, you were nominated for 3 Tonys.
Okay. I've gotten some other noms for other
Okay, things, so you got nominated for...
But if you put down the world, it's good. Yes, 3. 5.
All right. 20. No, but Steve, here's the thing. You know, what people don't realize, as a theater actor, you're doing 8 shows a week. Did you ever feel like one of the nights you're like, God, I suck, man. I didn't think I performed well. Because you got to stay consistent those eight days. You know? I mean, yeah, 8 days, totally. Right? So...
8 shows a week, yeah.
8 shows a week. So you're like, man, did you ever feel like, oh, man, I got to change it up, my style, because I didn't really feel that. And people think, oh, you did a great job. You did a great job. But in your mind, you're like, no, I did not do a good job. What do you do in that situation?
Well, it's funny. I mean, like, it's a great question. And that's one of the things I really value about Juilliard when I was talking about what I liked about it. I mean, a lot of it is technique. If you have good technique, the performance, what people see on the outside, doesn't always reflect how you're feeling on the inside. The important thing is honestly what they see, not what you feel. It's not an insular art form. You know, it's not therapy. So if you go to it being like, I didn't really think about that the dog was dead. Right. And I thought about something else. But people were dying in the audience because whatever it was you were doing that day made them think that the dog was dead. Then the dog was dead. You did your job as an actor. Mm-hmm. There are certain days and certain performances you can see where the person is having such a huge emotional response as an actor that the performance becomes inert because they're having all the feeling and they're not giving any space for you to have the feeling. Mm. So you have to kind of sometimes rely on your ability to trust it and know, like, it's like a slalom. You over the course of rehearsal, here are the gates for here, and here are the gates here, and here are the gates here. And I got to make sure I'm coming through here, and through here. Now, how I get there each night is going to be slightly different. I'm going to try to cut this edge more. I'm going to do this. Somebody gave me something different. I'm going to try to spin that in some way, and maybe I'll get myself into trouble. But I know where the slaloms that I have to hit for the evening. And that becomes more complicated. The longer in a run, the longest run I ever did, I was in a play on Broadway called Proof. And I had spent so much time in this play. I did the national tour of it. I started as the cover of it. I did the national tour. Then I did it on Broadway opposite Anne Heche. And by the time I got to Broadway with it, I'd been in close to a year. And, you know, you really do. You have to keep trying to trick yourself into forgetting that you know what's coming next. That's the hard part.
Yeah.
And that means you just have to keep trying to ask new questions. And you got to keep saying, like, what's the thing I'm going to focus on tonight? Because if I focus on my performance, you're dead.
You're dead.
If you focus on how it's going to come out, you're dead. But if you focus on what can I get from this person? What's my objective? What am I looking for? What can I try to change? What can I do? Then you'll find your way through the
farm. What's stopping you to try to change it, right?
Yeah.
But, you know, Stephen, the key thing is listening. I mean, every night, the way the actor responds, you got to listen.
That's it.
The opposing.
That's it.
Whoever's your scene partner, you got to listen, because the way they said it, you got to react as a human, you know? It's a prime example when I tell people, I mean, I'm a Meisner guy. That's what I thought.
Yeah.
And, you know, for instance, I tell people, look, let's just say my circumstance is that I got a part with Robert De Niro. I'm his supporting actor in a film. I got the news from my agent and I'm going crazy and I'm feeling joy. I'm like, oh my God, I can't wait. So let's say you're my brother, Steven, and you come in the door and I can't wait till I share the news. And all of a sudden I see you're kind of like down, and it's like, I want to say, how are you? But it's like, I take you in. I'm like, how are you? Like, what happened? Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I'm taking you in, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I learned in acting school, is that it's all about the other person.
Yeah, completely. And that's so, you know, like, I think a lot of people just think like, oh, no. Acting is all about, like, how do you say what you want to say? First of all, how do you learn those lines? And then secondly, like, how do you cry? You know, like, what are those two things? And it's, well, I mean, there are people who do that and do it brilliantly. But the actors that are really interesting are the ones who are wanting to commune with another human being. And listen. Yeah. And like, that's the whole reason that I think people like you and me went into this, is because it was like, You want to have a conversation. I went into acting mostly, you know, because I wanted to continue to be a kind of student of people, not because I wanted to perfect an idea of myself.
Right. Right. You know? I just love being like a degenerate gambler for 3 months and then a heroin addict for another 3 months and then a loving dad for another 3 months. You know, that's great.
Right.
You know?
So. And not busting your credit all the time. Right. You get to do all those things.
So, Stephen, here's the thing. You were really aggressive with the Frost-Nixon audition. You really wanted that part bad. And you actually literally, after you were in a play, after rehearsal, you went to London to see the director. Tell me about that story, because that takes a lot of balls, and I love that.
It was the moment. It was the moment that I kind of actualized as a professional. You know, up till that point, I was like a student of, like, I wanted to be in the play. I was like, I'm going to be dutiful. I'm going to, if you want, you know, like this sort of idea that I was telling you about changing your audition technique to think like I could solve a problem for you. Up until that point, I was doing okay being the guy who was like, I'm really good. Do you think I'm really good? I think I'm good. Do you think I'm good? Let's work together.
Right.
And I got this audition for this play called Frost-Nixon, which became the movie that Ron Howard directed. And it was on Broadway, and it was Frank Langella and Michael Sheen, these two titans. And the play is narrated in, like, the third part in it that is really, you know, kind of the index of the thing is this guy named Jim Reston, who wrote the book that the play is based on. And he was this reporter who helped uncover, you know, what Nixon had done. And I read it in Lincoln Center. Dan Sweet at Lincoln Center was casting this thing for the Broadway company. And Michael Grandage, who's this fantastic English director who ran the Donmar Warehouse for a while, was directing. And it had had a successful production in London that was coming from the West End with those two guys and those two guys only. And I remember reading the play and being like, and at this point, I was kind of looking at things like, and this is very dangerous as an actor, sort of being like, what are they going to be looking for? Is this part meet up with my resume? Do I have enough credits to be this part? And it was a big part. And I was like, I don't want to fall in love too much. I've been hurt now enough times to know I want to protect myself. I don't want to give everything to this part and then like almost get it. And then at the end, they give it to David Schwimmer because, you know, he's been on Friends for 8 years. I was like, that's painful. It's like falling in love and getting divorced and falling in love again. And I had been through that loop enough times that I gave this first audition and it went, I did all the stuff that I normally did and it went really, really, really well. And I was, that's when all those voices started to come into my head that like, I'm probably not going to get this. I'm probably now so good that I'm going to get myself right to the threshold and then I'm going to have to feel the door slam in my face. And I started psyching myself out right from the moment that they were like, they really like you. They want you to come back in. You're killing it. Here's a bunch of material. And I just started self-sabotaging myself. I had this callback. They sent more material. I didn't look at the material because I thought it was the material from the first audition that I hadn't worked on. Like, it was like, I did things I'd never done before. Walked into the audition. I was late. I had gotten the time wrong. I don't think I've done that in my entire career ever before or ever since. And I walked in and they were like, where were you? Where were you? We've put an entire hour aside. You were the first person. We put an entire hour aside for you. And I was like, huh? What are you? And they were like, did you get all the new material? And I was like, no. They're like, what is wrong? So I went in, I did the second audition, and it was a total bust. I mean, I got it together enough to not be embarrassed, but it was bad. And I left, and I was like, I just did that to myself. That was totally me. I just killed this opportunity because I didn't want to get hurt. It was too. I didn't want to be vulnerable enough to feel like shit. And I called my agent, the people I was telling you about, and they were like, yeah, the director responded to you like he would have hired the guy from the first audition, but the second audition is, he's unsure if you're the guy from the first audition, the second audition. So he's going to fly back to London. He's going to think about it. But so I was like, I cannot believe I did that. So I said, well, look, I'll fly to London. I'm the first guy. I'm the first guy. And I started to feel this like engine starting. I was like, I'm the first guy. I'll get myself to London. If he wants to see me, I'll show him. Thinking, in my head, like, he's the guy's gonna be like, oh, he's that guy from the first. How badly does he want it? And he's just gonna give me the part, maybe. And so I get a call back saying, yeah, you fly yourself to London, he'll see you again. So suddenly I'm like, oof. I was working on another play. And I was like, I had no money at this time. And I was like, okay, here I am. Am I going to double down? Am I going to pay my own ticket, fly myself on my one day off, thread this needle and go and try to get this job? Am I going to make myself even that much more vulnerable? Am I going to go through this, you know, this crucible and then may end up with nothing and even less than nothing because now I want to spend what money I have. And there was something in me. I was like, you know what? You know, fuck it. This is the moment. If I'm not going to get it, it's going to be because you didn't want me. It's not because I sabotaged myself. And I bought the ticket. I did all the stuff. And I flew. I did an overnight. I did a red eye overnight. Didn't change clothes or anything. I walked across, got to Heathrow, walked across London, walked into the Donmar warehouse. And it was this amazing moment where I threw the doors open of the Donmar warehouse and Michael was there. And I'm like, let's do this. Come on. Boom. This is what it is. And it was a moment where I was like, and I think if you're lucky enough to have that in your life, to go like, if I don't believe in myself, how the hell is anybody else supposed to believe in myself, believe in me? You know, I'm not going to be able to protect myself from feeling bad. There's no way to, if you don't get a part, you don't get a part. It's going to hurt. It's going to sting. But I'm not going to do it to myself. And I just did it. And I was like, I dare you not to give me this part. I dare you to like, to not. And then I was like, he's going to give me the part right here, right now. And he's not going to let me go back on the airplane and not give me this part. And of course, like, he was like, why don't you come over and sit down next to me? And then he didn't give me the part right there. And I was like, oh, my entire story. It's like, oh, it didn't happen. Oh, what did I told myself this whole thing? And then it turned, I on the way back, because I have English family, and on the way to Heathrow, on the way back, where I was like, oh, wow, I just blew it. This number, I thought it was my cousin, kept calling me over and over and over on the phone. And I thought it was my cousin calling me to talk, to see how it had gone. And I didn't pick up. And finally, right before I got through security, I picked up and I was like, hey. And it was the director who had been calling me for like 2 hours, being like, where have you been? I've been trying to go offer you this job. I had to call Equity in the States to see if I'm allowed to call you. And da, 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 da. And that's how. And then I flew home. It was like maybe the best moments, the best hours of my life was flying back on this plane, knowing that I had this incredible job waiting for me on the other end. And, you know, it's not always going to go that way. There's been plenty of times I put myself out there, plenty of times. And it's just been like, nope. But it's a lesson that I think I'll never forget. I'm never going to let myself take myself down.
Steven, I felt like the way you told me that story, it's like the national game, college football, and you know how they run out of their lockers and they just want to win so bad? Like, that's what...
Yeah, the sign.
Jump, running out of the locker room, you know, that tunnel, and let's go.
Yeah.
Awesome.
All right. It's game time. Yeah.
Game time, exactly. You did Enron, was another great show. I actually have the video, but I don't know if I should play it. It's funny about, I don't know, man. People might get offensive, but anyway. You did Enron.
Oh, is it the Jenna Jameson stuff, right? Is
that should I play it? Yeah, watch it.
They can find it. They can find that.
Well, this is what I love, because this is what I mean by an actor trying to really achieve something and really committed. Like, this is really believable, right? Look at this part right here.
I think porn could save every marriage in this country. I mean, as internet porn goes up, divorce rate is going to go way down. I mean, seriously, that is the industry to
find the point.
I want to give Enron a mistress.
That's why I like you, Andy. You're fucking nuts.
Now, having something off the books, even if it's just Jenna Jameson in an unmarked folder, your virtual mistress. She supports your marriage. She strengthens it. We can do the same for a company.
Explain.
Right, for those occasions that we need to offload, we create a company that exists purely to fulfill Enron's needs.
But he was so committed. You're like, listen, this is what's going to happen. Right? Listen, I have an idea.
Andy Fastow. Andy Fastow from the Enron, you know, chief financial officer. The things didn't go well for him. Made a lot of bad choices, Andy Fastow. And Jeff Skilling, Norbert Leo Butz, who's a brilliant player.
They had to change the stadium, the Enron. I don't know what's the Houston stadium. But all right, so now, here's the thing. We're going to talk about billions, but here's what I want to know. Brian Koppelman, or Koppelman, how do I say his last name?
Koppelman.
Koppelman? All right. Brian Koppelman, he grew up where you grew up, right? You guys knew of each other back in the days, right? When gas was like 90 cents a gallon, right? So
that's right.
He's the showrunner for Billions. He's the creator, I'm assuming, right?
He and David Levine, yeah.
David Levine, yes.
Who are best friends, yep.
Okay, so when he was writing the show, did he contact you and say, hey, Stephen, I got something. I want you to audition. Or did he offer the part to you? Because I know season one, you were more like a reoccurring guy, right?
Right. 100% neither.
Oh, okay.
Yes. You know, to Brian and David's credit, you know, they're awesome. And they had a great storied career before that. I knew Brian because Brian was a year older than my brother, Jeff.
Okay.
And they were pretty close. And I was close with Brian's sister, who was a year older than him. And myself, Jen. And so like in the theater community, our high school was pretty small and Brian was a player in that community. And Brian also went to Tufts before I went to Tufts, but Brian is a couple of years old. He's 5 years older than I am, or maybe a couple more than, but so, I mean, like certainly I knew of him. I don't think he knew of me. I think he definitely knew my brother. You know, like when Billions came out, I think Brian and I have talked about this. I think he was really delighted to see Kunken because it's like five Kunkens on the planet.
Right.
And he was like, oh, that must be Jeff Kunken. Jeff Kunken went into this, was my brother. And I think he was delighted to see that. It's his younger brother, Steve. And I came in and I think at that time I don't even remember what part I was reading for because it wasn't Spyros. It was, you know, I think that they had like a couple of blank scenes from The Traitors early on that they were like trying to figure out if you were a dollar bill or a Danzig or you were a Connerty or where you were going to fit into the thing. And then I think Spyros came up as like this is a possibility because I didn't necessarily fit one of the other things. And I loved that. And I was like, this part is hilarious. And I love those guys. Their writing is so... it's so rugged and it's just such great mouthfeel for anybody who's an actor. It's like, you just see the people on there. It just moves so quick. The referencing is so deep. The people are all so smart, even though people who are, you know, maybe are lower status are still smart. You get the hot dog vendor is smart. You know, everybody is moving along and has an agenda and a point of view. And I just love working on their stuff. So I went in and I was really lucky to know from Brian, I think, that character would recur. Mm-hmm. So, you know, because you do the pilot, you don't even know if the show's going to get picked up at that point. So I was super duper excited when that all came out. But I think the interesting thing is we've become close after the show. It wasn't it wasn't like an arm around a friend being like, come on, I want to bring you aboard.
Well, you know,
which is nice.
Assuming that, I was assuming, but I guess I was wrong, you know, because you guys did have a relationship in the past. That's why.
Yeah. I mean, we went to a school with like, where a graduating class was like 80 people. So you knew, especially because if you had multiple siblings at the school, you knew the names because it was like, you know, you saw them at the assemblies and stuff. So I definitely knew his family, but it wasn't, you know, I was a pipsqueak.
So
I was a pipsqueak then. I was a gum on the bottom of a shoe.
When you saw the opportunity to audition for this, did you do research on Brian and David with their other shows, their writing, you know, the pace of the scene? Like, what scene did you audition for? Was the scene in the pilot or no?
Yeah, I think it was. I think it was the scene where... I think it was the scene in the bathroom with Chuck where I'm like, something about the Kung Fu instructors or, you know, like something. It may have been both scenes. I think the pilot was pretty much what they had given us to sort of to work with for the scenes. It wasn't like a redo of the pilot. But, You know, I had seen at that point, I had seen a bunch of their stuff. So I had seen like their Oceans movie. Mm-hmm. I had seen Rounders. I had seen, oh God, what was the other one that I'm going to blank on the name? Something guy or I'm embarrassed to say, I don't remember. But like, and I was a fan, you know, I was a fan of theirs. And I also think it's like, sometimes you read an author or a playwright or a screenwriter and you kind of don't get it. And then other times you're like, I hear it. I intrinsically know the rhythm. And I feel like there are a lot of actors who work on Billions who just intrinsically know that, get that rhythm. Right. And then some terrific actors who just, that's not their wheelhouse. In this particular case, I was like, well, this makes tons and tons of sense to me. Like, I understand exactly what this guy is trying to to do because I see all the breadcrumbs that you've laid out. And then if they say you're missing that one, then it's like, oh, great, I get to pick that one up also. But you know, to understand what a compliance, not a compliance, because at that point I was working for the SEC. Once I got cast, I started really figuring out what that was and how that guy might manifest. But, you know, a lot of that work is done for you in the script. The more important thing for these guys is you have to know the nouns and you have to know the verbs of what you're doing, but a lot more is the adjectives about how those people are going to do it. That makes that show interesting.
Did you, when you auditioned, was it straight to producers or did you have to do the basic audition, then producer, and then studio tests and then network tests? What'd you go through?
I think in that one I auditioned for Brian and David and the casting director right away. And then I think they were just taping the tapes and then they were making their selects. And I think the studio was just basically saying, I think Showtime was like, yeah, if you like them, we like them. Unless there was a compelling reason that I didn't know about that was like, you know, we don't believe in this guy. I think the great thing about Showtime is that, and I imagine being a writer on Showtime is great that way, is because Showtime really supports their writers. I think they give them a lot of agency and saying like, that's what you want. We believe in your show and you know, you can make the choices that you want to make. And so I think the shows on Showtime are, you know, benefit from that a lot.
Wow. You know, and I also noticed that Brian, he actually loved basketball. He made his junior year varsity basketball team, but he gave up on it because he wanted to direct a musical.
There was a thing at our school called the Junior Musical, which was kind of the big like peach, in the, you know, the big cherry on top, the brass ring of going through the school, that if you were a drama student, one kid got to direct all of their peers in the junior year in a musical. And it was like a fundraiser, I think, for your prom the next year, if I'm correct. And my brother directed it, and Brian got chosen to direct it. And he was like, easy. It was like an all in, because being a director of anything is hugely, you know, time consuming. And I think they, you know, he got offered that and was like, he had that moment of like, you want to be a basketball player or do you want to, you know, do the thing that you're probably going to do. And I remember seeing his junior musical. I forget what it was, but I definitely was, because I saw every single one, because I was like, I'm going for that. I want that brass ring someday. Well,
I'm glad he made that decision, because that's, you know, here's a kid, you know, his junior year, even though he made his high school varsity team senior year too. But
he's good. He's good. I see him shoot the shot. He's got a good shot. He's a good athlete. He plays ping pong, and he and Damien play ping pong sometimes, and it's like, Damien's a sick athlete. Damien's an annoying athlete.
Looks athletic.
Yeah, you know, he's the kind of guy that just is like, oh yeah, is this a baseball? Throws an 80-mile, you know, first. But, you know, Brian is, they play ping pong around Christmas time. They set up a ping pong, you know, table at the studio, and they were good. You know, they're doing those crazy, you know, shots that go around in it and come back on the table with the spin and stuff. And he's good. He's a good athlete. And he's also, you know, Brian's really good at basketball too. So,
you know, when you became a regular, was it season three?
Three, yeah.
Did you feel mentally like, you know, when a player gets traded to a team or they signed this guy for the next 3 years to be, you know, let's say a professional team. Did you feel like, well, I'm a serious regular now, and it's showtime. I got to be, like, top shape, not shape physically, but I'm talking about the talent and acting and knowing what you have to do. Like, did you feel like I'm here to help to service the story? I'm here to help you guys.
All right, well, there are a couple of things. First of all, I mean, just by letter of the law, I'm not a regular. I've been all in, and there's a bunch of us who I think you'd be like, oh, you're that guy's right. You know, Ben Kim is a regular. You know, and the way that just by letter of the law, where our contracts are not. And that being said, you can feel the shift in commitment to feeling like a series regular when you go from being like, we'll use you when we use you, to being like, we're going to guarantee you this amount of episodes or that amount of episodes. So the same thing holds true. So I can answer your question, which is, yeah, you know, it's exactly like being an athlete, where, like, you're, you know, in soccer, you know, if you're out on loan, you know, which is something that they do in soccer that they don't really do in football, that they don't do in the American sports, which is, like, you can be loaned to a team for a season. If you're not in the plans for Wolverhampton, you know, the Wolves, maybe the Tottenham Hotspur will pick you up for a season and they'll pay your wages for the season and they'll use you and then they go back. And I think there's a little bit like, I want to get married. I would love to be a part of a team. I want to be part of the building blocks and in the DNA of something. It gives you a real, not to overuse the word, but it gives you a sense of agency in your work and a sense of comfort and a sense of being like you're home and you're with family. And, you know, for me, like, that not feeling like every time is an audition and every time is, you know, is a, do I have to hit the ball out of the park, even though I'm really only supposed to get on first base today, right? You know, and it like, that is a great peace of mind. And I think it helps Brian and David and the show as well. I mean, you can see people when you watch something and you're like, dude, your job was to come in, deliver the mail, say the funny line and get out. I'm not talking about me, but I'm talking like on another show that you watch. And you can see them coming without mail and try to book a series regular with something that isn't that. And your job is to fit into the world, not make the world, you know, shine a spotlight on you. And you get more, I think you feel more at ease to do that when you know that, like, yeah, well, this is today. Today my job is to bunt and move the guy over.
Right. You know? Interesting you say that. I love that. You know, it's like, listen, I'm here to service the story. That's it.
Yeah.
Wow. And you know, Showtime, like, people love your show. They, you know, I told my friends, I'm like, yeah, I'm interviewing the guy from Billions. He's like, who? I love that show. I'm like, okay, his character's Ari Spyros. He's like, oh, I love that guy. You know what they say? I say, what is he like? I want to see what they say. What does he play? Oh, he's that dweeb. You know what I mean? He's that dweeb. And
I hate that guy. I love to hate that guy. Yeah, idiot.
Steven, did you make a choice that you always felt like you want that power, man, and it gives you joy when you get that power? Was that one of your choices?
As Spyros?
Yeah, as Spyros, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think Spyros, one of his, you know, his driving forces is he really wants people to love him.
Yeah.
You know, he's, and admire him and look up to him. And more so that he even wants to be the puppet master. Because I think for Spyros, if he could sit in his desk and be the puppet master, that would not work for him. He's got to have it publicly happen. He needs the accolade. He needs people to go, ooh, Spyros is doing this or Spyros is doing that. You know, he's just one of these people who feels like he needs an audience and wants the audience, which is why when he continually tries to get people to laugh, even though people don't necessarily laugh, for him, it's like this, that's how he feels. He feels love and worth and, you know, what his power is by being embraced by other people. So it's like, I think there are some people, I think Axe is like a shark. Mm-hmm. I think Axe is like,
oh yeah.
Only for certain people does Axe need you to know that he killed you. So for Axe, there's plenty of people, it's like, he's dead in a corner and it's fine. you don't need to see, know who drove the knife through your neck. Mm-hmm. But for Spiros, it's like he would sign the fortune cookie and he would tell you, and he'd want you to be alive first before he did it. He'd want nine people around. And I think it's really totally human. I think that you know, where it's tweaked up is his inability to see the amount of times he's failed at it. And I think that's delicious. I love that part of it. I think that's what ultimately makes him endearing, mm-hmm. is that he's willing to stand back up again and try one more time, you know, even though he struck out all those others.
Well, you can see the reaction, especially the relationship with you and Paul Giamatti. It's like, you guys hate each other. Like, he's like, yeah. you know, like there's a scene that you're on the phone and then you hear, no, you're not on the phone, but yeah, I think the lady's on the phone. And yeah. He's like, he's talking bad about you and you're right there. Like, you set him up.
Oh yeah. He's like the confused dog. Yeah. And, oh, isn't right. Is that who's the confused dog? You always look like a confused. Yeah. I mean, Paul is so awesome. You know, it's
such a great actor.
I gotta say it's a show of such good actors. I mean, we're just the ridiculous embarrassment of riches that when you come into a table read and you're like, oh, it's Rob Morrow. It's Paul Giamatti, Damian Lewis, it's Maggie Siff, it's Asia Kate Dillon. I mean, it's like there's just, there's Kelly O'Coyne, Dollar Bill. What are you going to do?
Steven, are you close with Danny any of them? Isaac. Like, did you become great friends with any of them? Any of the cast?
I've become friends with all of them.
Oh, yeah, okay.
It's a really, really tight company. And they're all like, I talk to the Axe Cap folks every single day. You know, we even in this pandemic where we text all the time, there's a group of us who just are really, really close. I text with Damien in London, you know, Paul was mad. He was just mad when I joined Axe Cap. So, you know,
all right.
Not true. Paul's an awesome, awesome guy. A fantastic guy. Yeah. I think it's a really, really friendly group of people. They've engendered a kind of working environment there that is really fun to come to the set. You know, like they've made it a really delightful place to work.
Why are you so obsessed with coffee, man? Talk to me about that. Where does
coffee? Cool.
All right, here, you know what? Here's another one. Right? You got this one right here. Like, you love your coffee. I mean, do you own a business in coffee? Is there going to be like Kunken Coffee? What's going on there?
You just stay tuned. Stay tuned. Talk about it. Just yet. All right. Stay tuned. There is something. There's something coming. Eddie, I'll let you know. I'll give you the exclusive when it breaks, but there's something coming.
Make sure you invite me to your premiere of coffee. I'm sure it's going to be a nice cafe down in Brooklyn somewhere, you know.
You'd be surprised. No, it's coffee for me is I could deep dive this and the show's not going to be long enough, but you know, when I was at Juilliard, I was drinking 24 cups of coffee a day. Like, which was ridiculous. Somebody had to point it out to me and was like, dude, you're killing yourself. but for me, it's like we've become a world where we just consume things and we don't even know what we're consuming. We just throw it back. And I missed, especially as an actor, you know, we are such nomads through our lives, mm-hmm. that I missed this kind of like knowing something deeply. And I made this conscious choice about 10 years ago that I, or 15 years ago that I was like, I want to know everything there is about one thing. And I chose coffee because coffee is like this great, you know, across the globe prism through which to view all these different facets of our lives. You know, it's understanding industry, it's understanding history, it's understanding ecology, it's understanding, you know, business and the vertical chain of coffee. And then I was also just, I love the beverage. I really like the beverage. And the more you know about a specific thing, the more the deeper dive you realize that there is to go. But it's helped me understand and contextualize lots of different things in the world by focusing on the micro. I can understand the macro. And it's really interesting. There's something about that bean that goes from the tropics, mm-hmm. across the world and goes to pretty much the second highest traded commodity on the planet after oil. I mean, it's oil for human beings. And, you know, it's, it's a pretty intense business. It's also a place where, you know, not unlike the way coffee sort of grew, it was like, oh, look at that. I like that.
I'll show you that picture later.
Is that you?
I want to show you afterwards. But you know, Steve, if there was Coffee Anonymous,
yeah,
would you be the first one enrolled in there?
No, because you know, I think I'd be a group leader at Coffee's Anonymous. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think right now I allow myself three double espressos a day. That's enough. That's a lot. I make them all myself.
So you have three espressos a day?
I have three, yeah.
Holy, how do you sleep?
I don't. Sleep is no, I have to stop. I do one in the morning, and then I do one to get me through the late morning, and then I have one in the afternoon. Mm. That's it. And then I stop around 6.
Oh, all right. You know what I love about you, Stephen? You're a family man. And I love the fact that you have a daughter, which really, really impressed what you did and how you got your daughter. And, you know, there's a picture right here. I want to show you this picture right here. It reminds me of when your daughter gets older and she says, Happy Father's Day. She's going to talk about moments like this, how you love your daughter so much. And I love this because I actually met you guys at the U.S. Open last year. You and your castmate.
Naomi. Oh, and Costable, right?
Yeah. It was, but tell me about the relationship because I could see you give so much attention to her, and you adopted her, right? At 6 months.
Yeah, ago? Naomi is Ethiopian, and we've been a family since she's 6 months old, and we traveled across the world, and you know, started our family that way, and she's, you know, she's the best thing that ever happened to my wife and I. You know, she's a delight. And it's this funny, like, balance of nature and nurture that, you know, you realize, I think, no matter how you build a family, but, like, she's a goofball. I think she is every bit of goofball that I am and that we are. And she's just brilliant and beautiful and kind and crazy different, like, you know, viewpoints on the world. And and it's hard. This is a hard time right now to raise a kid. I mean, the world is nuts, and she's in virtual school, and I can't imagine what the seeds that are planted in this period for this generation. They have my hats off to them. My hearts are out to them because it's not easy. It's not an easy time for them. But she's awesome.
Yeah, and so you actually met your wife. She was a stage manager.
No, director. She started as an actor. She was a kid actor, and she's been. You can look her up on IMDb because she was a very successful kid actor, and then she became a theater director and is a very successful theater director right now. So she wasn't direct. She was still an actor when I met her, and then. And then she's become a director, and she's amazing. Jen Thompson.
Yeah. Good for you. You know, there's one scene in Billions. did you create his movement and his voice and speech the way, like, he sits and all that? That's what I realized. Like, yeah, right? You did that, right? But
I mean, I think that's basically, they've given him those lines, and it's like, there's no other way to do them.
Yeah. You know what's awesome? It's like, whenever you have something, you achieve something, just have that joy. It's in your body, right? So here's the scene right here. This is the best. I think it's hilarious. You did create a lot of behavior here, but let's take a look at this scene.
I hate every pore of you.
Look at your walk. Like, yeah, I feel good.
What the fuck are you doing? What the fuck?
Come on, man. It can't get better than that, man.
That's my brother Kelly O'Coin, that was one of the most fun days I've ever had shooting anything. It really was. We got to really destroy that Porsche Boxster. That was insane.
Wow. Showtime must have had a big bill, huh?
Well, yeah, I think the plan was that, and they told Kelly this, they were like, if you keep hitting the door panel in the same place, mm-hmm. we'll be able to remove the door panel, put a new door panel on, and resell the car for, you know, a chunk down, but we'll be able to resell the car. So they bought a used Boxster, and Kelly just went and just destroyed it. And like, over the course of the day, it was like, and that's a line item we can just chalk off right there. And, you know.
that was a good. I mean, like, you know, that I love fun. How you, oh, as so an actor, fun. How you create these relationships. It's like I got the relationship with you and Giamatti. I got the relationship with you and him. Like, it's like, and I love how when you accomplish something, you have that joy. Like, yeah, I'm the bomb. And the next thing you know, you're poor.
Well, I give major prop. The writers on, you know, Brian and David and the teams that they put together are amazing, you know, because they have all of these, they have all these toys that they can play with. And every now and then they're like, this one and this one, that would be hilarious. We put them in a thing and shook them up and put them out. And it's like, and when I found out that we were going to get that really fun arc with Dollar Bill, which is gone a couple seasons, I love it. Kelly is just such a blast to play with, and we have such a good time. And I love playing. And there's like literally, there's nobody that they would put any of us with that I think we're not just like thrilled when we turn the page at the table reads, and we're like, oh my god, I get to have a scene with you. You know, it's like, it's just gifts. And then, you know, that's because they built these characters to be just so on point and unique.
Yeah, I mean, listen, your show's a hit, man. Everybody loves. You know, and I'll be honest with you, I just started watching it this year. You know what I mean? Because I'm like,
really?
My friends are like, what? You're missing it? Are you out of your mind? But earlier today, I had to take this picture. So you're not in this scene, but it's where Damian Lewis eats his good pizza. So let me fix it for you right here. Is it this picture? No, not this one. No,
that's me with a coffee.
Oh, no, is it?
That's me in Hawaii with a cup of Kona.
Well, anyway, yeah. Let me see. How do I do? Oh, coffee three slippers. Nope, that's not you. I'll show you later.
Where is he eating? He's eating like a DeFaro's? No, what kind of pizza?
All right, let me get it right now. Hold on a minute. You're pumping me up right now. Okay, so this is when I met you and David at the U.S. Open last year. You know, and your daughter was there. I think she was on the side. I didn't know that was your daughter. I was like, oh, shit. Then I found out, and I was like, oh, man, she should have joined us in the picture.
That was the same. Right after we took that picture, we took a picture with some NYPD, and that was like, that was her. She was so psyched, and we were so happy to get a shot. So you don't have to worry, because the female officer from the NYPD sort of made her day.
All right, so here's the picture I'm talking about. Let me do it right now for you. How's that? How am I going to do this here? Here we go. Nope. Is it this? Wait. You and I. Oh, man. I'm such a rookie in this. Hold on a minute. Well, anyway, you see this picture right here? Oh, here we go. 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 All right. So this is where Damian Lewis sits when he eats his pizza. It's right up the block from me in Queens. It's in season one. You see him eating the pizza like he's having a meeting.
Yep, yep, yep.
So I said, let me take a picture. That's exactly where Damian Lewis sits at the pizzeria when he has his meeting.
That's hilarious.
Yeah.
You know what? You could literally, and people have done it. Like the Billions food tour is insane. Like insane. It's all the best. It's all the best edibles in New York City. Oh, seriously.
This was in Queens. It's a middle village called Rose's Pizza. That's where they did this.
That's right. Right.
I don't know if
I haven't been there. I've been to my jam is DeFaro's. Have you ever been to DeFaro's out in Brooklyn? In Midwood?
No, the best pizzeria, you go to L&B in Bensonhurst. That.
Yeah, people like.
That is big leagues right there, my man.
All right, we'll split it. I put DeFaro's up there. DeFaro's, I think, is. Tomorrow's is pretty tough to beat, but I'll try L&B. We'll do a tour one day. We'll get in the car when COVID's over.
I'll pick you up. Steve, I'm like actually like 5 miles away from you. I'm in Queens, and you're on the Red Hook side. Are you near the BQE?
Yeah.
Yeah, yep. Exactly. You're near the Barclays Center?
No, that's a little more. That's a little more sort of central Brooklyn. We're right on the water.
Oh.
So if you come around from like Brooklyn Heights, and you follow the waterfront, that's us. We're sort of right.
So pretty much where the Twin Towers were, if they were still there, you could see the perfect view.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, we have the only front facing view of I think Lady Liberty from Red Hook. When you ever see those commercials, what is it? Liberty, is it the one where they're like, mm-hmm. yeah, Liberty Mutual, and they're all standing in front of that. They filmed that in Red Hook, mm-hmm. or at least they took the blue screen shot for that in Red Hook. That's like down by the water.
All right, so I'm going to end this broadcast, but Steve, don't go anywhere. I need something from you, all right? Don't go anywhere. Don't worry. I don't need no.
I won't.
Not that guy. All right, so listen, this is Stephen Kunken, Billions. Hopefully they'll come back, with this COVID stuff. I know you guys had to stop in the middle. But it's been a pleasure, man. Steven, seriously,
thank you.
I want young actors to get inspired by your story, man. How you got?
Oh, man, thank you. What an incredible! You took me on a tour down memory lane. This was awesome. I really, really appreciate it.
Well, thank you for being on the show. Even though I was harassing you for like a month or two, right, all summer, like, come on, get up.
I was bad.
What are you waiting for?
It's bad.
It's all right.
I took a break. I took a break from the world for a long time.
I don't blame you. I apologize. All right, let me finish this. But stay here, Steve.